Good afternoon, dear participants. On the previous session, you have heard about creative skills of students. But what about another skills? Different studies have highlighted that beyond knowledge, other skills related to individual patterns of behaviors, attitudes, and personality traits are crucial both for professional success and for personal fulfillment. These skills have many different names, such as 21st century skills, broad skills, or non-cognitive skills. Educators have known about the importance of non-cognitive skills for a very long time. For centuries, people like Horace Mann were emphasizing the importance of perseverance and hard work in the 1800s. Nowadays, there is somewhat of a revolution of another kind, and it's related to measurement of these skills. As for a long time, people had this idea that they are very difficult to measure, if not possible. Innovative organizations are doing a big step into assessing these skills at a wide scale. And one of these organizations is the Innovation Department of the City Foundation that has developed prototypes for such skills. In this session, you will see demonstrations of prototypes that focus on citizenship, collaboration, personality traits, and empathic behavior. What kind of tools are meaningful if an answer isn't necessarily right or wrong? I'm delighted to introduce Romy Nordhoff. She is head of prototypes at CITOLAB, a multidisciplinary innovation team that focuses on the development of prototypes for educational measurement. With a background as an educational and assessment expert, Romy conducts design research into innovative testing methods. With her team and in close contact with students and teachers, she develops prototypes for the education of the future. Please welcome Romy Nordhoff.
Thank you very much, Saminga. I think I can start now sharing with my presentation, correct?
Please.
Okay, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Romy Nordhoff. As Samina told you, I'm from the Netherlands, from CITO Foundation. And today I'm going to tell you a bit about educational measurement of non-cognitive skills. Happy to be here today. The little program I got made together for you today will consist of a lot of examples. And I've brought a lot of screenshots of the assessments we made, but I will start with you with a quick introduction to give an insight in how my innovation department, where I work, how we work, how we focus during our innovation work we do. And afterwards, I will show the examples of the prototypes from citizenship, collaboration, empathic behavior, and personality traits, in hope they inspire you in your work as well. I work at CITOLAB, that's the name of my innovation department, and all the services, prototypes, deliverables has this logo on it. And we develop prototypes in educational assessment for primary, secondary, or university assessments. We focus on creating prototypes for either new content, so the skills I'm going to talk to you today about are example of that. So for instance, we make assessments about citizenship, but also digital literacy, collaboration. But we also make another type of assessments, and that's are the more traditional contents, but in a more innovative way. So for instance, we make an assessment for speaking skills using automatic speech recognition. So it's a very fun department to work. And I'm going to show you some examples today. And I will start by showing you how we develop our prototypes and what evaluation we use when we develop these. We start also always with that we want to make sure that we make a correct interpretation of the score from an assessment so that the measurement perspective is right. But we try to balance it out with the intended use, so the educational perspective. You want to make sure that you not only assess that part that is easy to assess, because we know how we can assess it standardized, but we also make sure that we assess in a meaningful way. And we aim to do this in making sure that the assessment we make is a more valid assessment than a more traditional assessment would be. So we always have this type of quote in our mind when we develop our new prototypes, and it balances out the use and the interpretation of a score. So to make sure that it's appropriate, we make sure that the score has the right meaning, and that we are able to use the score for the intended purpose in the classroom. Now, how do we develop our new types of assessments? We always go through these four stages, which in between have a type of go, non-go moment. But first we start with a design lab where teachers and students tell us what they think that should be assessed, or what they think is very constructive to test. So when we know what students want to be assessed for, or teachers want to assess, we start designing a new assessment. And by designing, I mean literally screens designing. There's not any software yet. It's just a PowerPoint presentation or a design. And we test it. And later on, if the designs are proven to be successful, then we start developing the assessment in a software prototype, and we start sharing it to the education in the Netherlands mostly. This seems quite linear, but actually it's more of a circle process where we go a bit back and forth. I think innovation is always a little bit messy, so that's okay. But what's good to know is that we try to make sure that we validate every step in the new assessment we make. And we start by validating the relevance of the idea we have. So if we're starting to assess collaboration, we wanted to know that education thinks it highly of collaboration, want to assess it, want to make sure that it's in their curriculum. So we start by validating the relevance of the idea we have. Then we go to the right upper corner where we validate the consistency of the design. And if the designs are proven to be successful, so we make sure by using, for instance, screening, interviews, thinking aloud protocols, that students can work with the assessment we have, then we are going to develop a prototype, a first version of a prototype. And this we will test on the usability. So if they're going to sit behind the computer and they're making the test, are they sure they can navigate through it? Can they click it through by themselves, or do they need help? And if that's the case, then we're going to test the prototypes on how effective they are and how effective they assess the skill they are meant to measure. Not all prototypes you make obviously go through all four phases. Sometimes there is a go, no go, and we decide that we have to go back to the scratch board and make sure that the prototype has another idea. But I've brought along four prototypes from non-cognitive skills with you to show today. First, about these skills. Yeah, it's a quite hard skill, because what's not in the name, non-cognitive, it's not a very informative description, because it could be all kind of skills, actually. There's a lot of names. Only if you look in English, you have a lot of different names you can see, like, such as soft skills, character skills, personal success, personality traits, all kind of skills. But what is most importantly, when you try to start to assess these skills, is that it's quite hard to do so. And I think that's because of three reasons. Because the skill is quite tacit. It's not very defined. It's quite implicit, not codified. So if you talk to experts, they kind of have the same meaning, but not exactly. So it's a quite hard skill to get an objective assessment about. What's also very challenging for measuring these non-cognitive skills is that they are very specific for the situation they are in. So if you're using your skill in one situation or another, you always have a little bit of situation specificity in it. So it's very hard to make sure that you can catch it with one test. And third of all, the subjectivity is a problem in measurement of non-cognitive skills. It's not as objective to measure. An assessor is needed, so a human is needed to differentiate between good or poor performance, and that makes it always a little bit more subjective. But there are a lot of things you can do. For instance, if you look into the literature, these are the kind of ways people find to assess non-cognitive skills. For instance, they try to delineate the construct into making it more specific what the construct is about, try to define and distinguish what is poor performance, what is a good performance, and actually they are using very cognitive way in delineating this construct, or using cognitive assessment as a proxy. A lot of time you see examples of making the subjective objective by making sure that there are a lot of assessors, and if they are generally supporting one opinion, then probably that's the most objective opinion there is. What you also can see is that there's a lot of sampling of performance and opinions. So there's not one test, but you can use a lot of tests to make sure you can catch the skill better. And I think what's maybe the most important one is the bottom one, abandoning the existing measurement paradigm. So I think in assessment of some non-cognitive skills, it's very important to think there's not one right or wrong answer. So you should not approach the assessment exactly like that, but you have to see what the students are doing and make sure that the examples and the assessments trigger exactly the right behavior so they can show what they can within this skill. I've brought along four examples with you today, and I'm going to show you and I'm going to talk you through them. And I want to start you by showing it's a Dutch name, Kieskleurig, an assessment for citizenship. It's a new part of the curriculum in the Netherlands. And normally teachers assess this construct by testing the knowledge about citizenship. So what do you know of democracy? What do you know about human rights? But there's so much more in citizenship as a skill than knowing a lot about the construct itself. And there is some difficulty about, because there's not one right way to be a citizen of a country. So there's no right or wrong. And we try to make a solution by visualizing all the differences that is within this construct. Now, how did we do that? It was quite a search. I've brought with you the different designs you can see we made in our design lab to talk with all the experts in the field in the Netherlands. And you can see it has a lot of stages and different interfaces. Surprising result, I think, of this prototype was that the most experts were agreeing on that this assessment shouldn't be a very long assessment with a lot of items, but because they wanted to make sure that the depth of the construct was really important. So they wanted to have a bit more longer discussions or more longer essays or more longer input from the students instead of more of them. So what did we make? KiesKleur has a digital board, which is monitored by the teacher in the class. So that's the one you see on the left. And every student has a mobile where he has a web-based app. And on the digital board, there is always a statement about a social issue. And the statement has two perspectives, and one is more of your cup of tea, we would say, and one is more like not your perspective, but some other's perspective. Students are asked to choose one of those perspectives and also to give an insight in why they are choosing that perspective. And what you can see on the big screen in the class is that the statement has some real-time data showing. So it starts with a 50-50, and students are going to answer the question on their phone. So they are, for instance, going to vote on more right perspective or more left perspective, and you can see that changing life in the classroom data. We were a bit afraid that people were socially accepting answers were given, because they can see, oh, a lot of people are going for the more right perspective in this case, but partly because the way the statements were constructed, they did not perfectly try to use this tendency. There was not a right or a wrong perspective, and also because the teacher in this case empathized that the difference between citizens is a very part of this construction. They were not that socially committed to make sure that they had one or right answer. Per statement, you can see the final calls of the students, and the teacher can give a lot of quotes or a lot of triggers for further discussion. And later on, the student gets a more personal output from this prototype. And I have tried to make sure that you can see them on the mobiles on the screen. The students did get a lot of statements, and in the one of the final answers is which one is most important to you. So you rank the statements. And later on, you can see how many classmates did exactly rank those statements just like you, but also how many different statements there are in the class. So we can visualize how many different perspectives in one classroom were available. So in this case, you can see that some classmates had the exact same statement on number one, and that a lot of people have chosen the same reason for choosing the right perspective or the left perspective. So this is visualizing there are some differences. It's also visualizing there are some students thinking along the same line as you. And a student has quoted that he found after using this prototype that it made him think about how he's in a bubble. So I found out my classmates often think different about things than I do, and I'm often in a bubble without realizing it. And that was for us a very successful summation of this prototype, because I think by starting a point, you want students to know that citizenship is just about being different, but also respecting the other differences that are in society. Because we ask students to give a reason why they are choosing left or right, and we think if you do that in a more sittings, so you use this prototype more often, you can discover patterns. So for instance, you could see if a student has very often a socially motivated choice or more ideological motivated choice. And without judging about whether that's good or not, you can discuss these patterns in your school as well. So in conclusion, sometimes presenting the outcomes just as objectively as you can see them being administered in your classroom can be a very good start about the construct that you're new in assessing in education. I will move over to my second example. And this is a collaboration game, actually. It's a game-based assessment. And we wanted to assess collaboration between students And it was very difficult because in collaboration, you have a kind of dependency on the people you are collaborating with. So that's a very difficult assessment if you want to make sure that it's assessed individually. What we try to do by game-based assessment is trigger the right behavior to observe and to reflect later on formatively. So this is an example of formative assessment. I've just included this slide to show that collaboration is a very multi-faced skill. So there's a lot of text on it, not because you have to read it, but to show it's a very complicated skill to illustrate. But we also know it's very easy to see if a collaboration goes right. So we're kind of experts on this. But it's just a complicated skill to measure. What we did do was we create an escape room to trigger the right behavior in the students. And in this case, we presented them with a digital opponent. So the whole classroom is playing against one digital, in this case, a hacker. And they're not playing against each other because we want them to collaborate against a digital opponent. And in this case, the hacker has placed some fictional ransomware and they have to make sure they find the right passcode to unlock it. And to make sure that they are not dividing tasks, but they are collaborating together to get this this escape room done, we have made 10 different assignments, which are mostly riddles. So it's not very clear what you want, what you have to do to get the password out of it. So they really have to need to collaborate and need everybody's opinion and information to get the work done. So in this case, you can see the assignments within the escape room are cognitive, but making sure you get them right, collaboration is needed. So the non-cognitive skill is needed here. Because there's a time limit, we observed in the classrooms that the time pressure made students acted more naturally. So when they started, they know, oh, it's about collaboration. I have to do it nicely. I have to work together. I have to give feedback the right way. But because there was a time limit, they started to act more naturally. So if we talked to the tutors and the mentors of the students, they say, oh, the nature, true nature came through. We asked the students first in a paper-based prototype to reflect on their collaboration skills. And we used the formative loop to do that. So in the beginning, we asked the students to make sure they had a feed up moment. So where am I heading? What's a good collaboration doing? What do I need to do to get a better collaboration out of it? Then we asked them to play the escape room game. And then we asked them, give themselves feedback. So they go from feed up to feedback. Now, how did I do? I tried to collaborate. I tried to do it nicely. What did go okay? What did go a little bit poor? Maybe could do better next time. And that's the feed forward they are going to give themselves. So how do I get there? If I want to get better in collaboration, what do I need to improve? So this is the formative loop they were answering on paper. So we triggered the behavior, we triggered the reflection, and we tested these paper prototypes, and we saw that there was a good reflection process on the student side, but it was also a paper-based assessment, and that has a lot of paper. You can see my kitchen table here, a lot of paper. So after we know that these questions were the kind of questions we wanted to ask, we made it in a web-based app, which is called Reflex in this case. So in this case, we have included the questions from the paper-based prototype in a digital app. So students get a code and they come into a session and they are asked about their behaviors within collaboration they want to work on. So they select, for instance, I want to get better in trusting my other group members, or I want to get better in giving a good feedback. So they select behaviors they want to improve. They do the activity that can be still the escape room. It also can be something else. And they then self-report how they were functioning. Was it more more expertly or more novicely, and they reflected on their own behavior. This was input for a teacher dashboard, and you can see here on screen, these are designs, so it's not yet working, but you can see a kind of a profile per students that's selected from the self-reports that are given. So on the top you can see the radar, where you can see that in this case Haley has given herself some feedback, and you can see, for instance, those yellow parts, that's where she has given herself a higher score than the last time she was reflecting on her collaboration skills. So on the top you can see her latest self-reports reflected, and on the bottom part you can see the bar charts, where you can see some ups and downs. So that's a pattern of behavior through time. So if reflex is used more oftenly, you can use these bars to see which pattern is evolving. Is somebody growing? Is it going down? So you can have a classroom discussion, or we think that's the most best way to do here, an individual discussion between a student and a teacher about their behavior and where they want to grow. Teachers report to us that this screen can really start these conversations about this skill. That brings me to my third example. This is called Sort Board, and Sort Board is about empathic behavior. It's also a part of citizenship, but we have made one single prototype for this as well. And what's really difficult in assessing this kind of behavior, there is no right. So there's no right way to be empathic to your students, neighbors, friends, etc. But luckily, there is a statistical method to make sure you can get the right information out of the situational judgments, actually. So what we try to do is make sure that we had the right construct here. So we know that acting empathetically is a very important skill to have in school and later in work. We also know students differ in ability to do this. But we know from literature that you can also practice this skill and you can get better in it. But there's no right or wrong. So how do you measure if people are practicing with this skill, but there's no right or wrong, so you cannot make sure that a score reflects that growth. What Q sorting does, and this is a statistical method, is a way of making sure that participants, students in this case, place viewpoints. So we have a little card with a situational judgment in a grid, as you can see the girl has here on this picture in the slide. By making sure that students are putting all those situational judgments in this grid from left to right, making sure that this is more how I view it, this is less how I view it, you get a ranking. This ranking is very personal. Because the grid is for everybody the same, it's the normal distribution. In statistical measurements, you would like to have data to have a normal distribution, and the grids make sure this is so. That makes it possible to do a factor analysis. So there's not an analysis in right or wrong answers, but with which factors contribute to the different patterns students use. So it was quite abstract, I think, but I have brought along some screenshots that I think that will make it more clear. So a student is presented with some situational judgments. For instance, the card you see in the middle now is saying something like, you're working with a classmate, you're working together on one project, and he wants to work on a time that's inconvenient for you. In the end, you give in, you work on the time he suggested. And the student is asked, is that something you would do? Would you give in? or would is it something you would rather not do? So they judge all these cards in, is something I would do, is something I would not likely do. So you have two stacks of cards. After you've made those two stacks, you present it with the grid. And then you are asked to place the cards in the grid. The more you move the picture to the left, the less you agree with the action presented in the card. The more you move the card to the right, the more you are agreeing with the action there. So you're arranging the cards relatively to each other and making a ranking. As you can see, the grid has the same characteristics as the normal distribution, and that makes it for us possible to get a look at the variables behind those cards. Because what we did was, in these cards, there were a bit of variables making sure that we can do analysis. For instance, the extent to which you knew the person in the sketch. Was it a friend of yours? Was it acquaintance? Was it an unknown person? Could influence whether you are acting empathically or not. Also, if the situation is offline, more distant from you, online, more distant from you, or is it offline in the real world? And we are thinking that's also an from influence for people to act empathically or not. Right now we are investigating if this is so that we have we have researched this with a couple of students, but we have also presented them in the meantime with a dashboard. So for instance, we show how many times a specific card is put completely to the right side or completely to the left side. So in that way, even though we are still researching the specific variables, we can by now already fuel the classroom discussion about acting empathically, and students can already discuss between themselves, oh, why did you put that card on the left? I was putting it very much to the right. I'm going to my last example now, and this is the example of an assessment of personality traits. The big five traits, if you are familiar with them. And the difficulty here is that we have some assessments about personality traits, questionnaires with a paper or the digital questionnaire, but they are very distant for the age group we have. So they do not very good match the target group. But above all, we saw that they did not trigger a good conversation in a classroom about the traits that were found within them. So we tried to make a solution in making a game-based assessment about it to make sure the students are getting a lot more known about their behavior and the patterns and the personality traits. We have done this because a team of a school in the Netherlands wanted to make sure that they have more attention for personality traits of their students. And they wanted to give their students more insight in the personality traits, because we know it has a lot of influence on school success and work success later on. And we think it's necessary they understand their personality trait better to do so. These were the five personality traits that were in this game, the big five characteristics. And they, as you can see, we have put them on a scale from, for instance, more open to more closed, or more neurotic or more calm. And they describe on average how people differ from each other. And the aim of this assessment was initiating the discussion, but at the same time, making sure that we are assessing the personality traits of the players in our game. How did we do that? In this case, the player has to start and join a game with a group of classmates. That can be easily done to use a code, for instance. And they are presented with a situation sketch. For this example, you see a situation in a bus, and you see two strangers arguing. And what do you do? Every time a sketch is presented, students are asked, what would you do? and they type in an open answer. So it's not a multiple choice. They type in an open answer and they get quite some sketches. And after a sketch has come by, players were asked to match the given answers of other players with the avatar's name. So in this case, somebody answered, yeah, I would do nothing, I would look away. And the player is asked, do you think Adam, Toya, Mark, or Hajar is saying this? So who do you think this answer is from? And they are asked to do that for every given answer from the group. So also, I turn my music louder. Would you think that Toya, Adam, Mark, or Hatchet answered this? So after they have done that, they're asked to label the question of the answer that students have given. So in this case, I turn my music louder. Do you think that's a bit more of a personality trait, openness? Is it more chaotic, is more calm? So they choose one of the personality traits and label it the answer with this trait. So players assign a personality trait to each answer. And after you've played it, you can get, in this case, we are Toya here, the player gets an overview of the personality traits other students were giving to your answer. So you have assigned some personality traits. So in this case, Toya has given some answers and she is perceived very calm, but also very outgoing. So the situation can be here a bit different regarding the sketch she has. And the way it's now used in Dutch education is that we use it in combination with the questionnaire for personality traits. So in the game, pairs are reporting which traits are known, and in the questionnaire, you answer the questions yourself. So you're checking peer review with self-report. And we have found that for two personality traits, there is a big correlation. So on neuroticism and conscientiousness, the game and the valid questionnaire were assessing the same. There was no significant correlation for agreeableness, extroversion, and open-minded. So the game was not that good in catching these kind of personality traits. So work to be done there, I think. And going over to my last conclusion, I would like to summarize some important facts once again. I've showed you some examples of making sure you trigger natural behavior, for instance, using game-based assessment or situational judgment cases to make sure you can trigger behavior that can be observed or assessed. I've also have shown you some examples of the importance of data visualization. So if you're not labeling it right now, or you're not giving it a judgment, not a grade or not a good or a poor, it can be very informative for a student and a teacher as well to make sure you have data visualization as objective as you have found it in your assessment. And we have discussed the use of student feedback, self-reporting. It's not a new way of assessment, but I think it's a very underestimated one, because by using student self-reflection, you also involve them in the learning process of the skill you are trying to make them grow in, and you help to create a sense of quality there. So I hope that you are now a little clearer on how you can trigger, evaluate, measure different constructs, and maybe that the examples have given you some new ideas. And I hope you can focus on what you can do instead of what is difficult in this assessment. And this brings me to my the end of my presentation. I think there are a couple minutes left if there aren't any questions. And I would like to thank you, for your attention so far.
Thank you, Romy, for sharing innovative assessment techniques with us.
And very welcome.
May I ask you a question from our audience? Please, I'm going to read it. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Romy, for this very interesting example of the hacking game-based escape room assessment. You said that you use it for formative assessment. assessing collaboration. I am interested to learn your opinion of using this kind of game-based assessment for summative purposes. Would that be possible?
I think if I look in the Netherlands, game-based assessment and these kind, specifically game-based assessment, are not mostly used summative. When they are used in human research departments, so it's not education. Then you can see some summative uses. I think if standing on itself, on its own, game-based assessments may not be a very good summative assessment, because you have to also include some reflection. So if a student is, for instance, put into the position that he can summarize why he acted some way, so he can include some reflection to it, then I think it can be a very solid way of assessing. But most games I know of are used formatively or used as a part of a summative assessment. I hope that answers the question.
Yes, and you said about self-assessment, but we have another question. Does it include elements of peer judgment where participants in a group give marks about the performance of their group mates?
Yeah, I'm not sure in which prototype is really
it's about meant the collaboration here. Task.
Okay, so about the collaboration. Yeah, we have thought about it. Did we want to include the peer judgment? We haven't included it because we think that not every participant or candidate has to collaborate on the same way. So you don't want to end up all in the same profile on a good collaborator is dot dot dot. But we saw that students were giving some peer feedback on their own. So when they are, for instance, there was some time pressure in this game, and when they thought somebody was not hurrying up, so they gave really easily some feedback during the activity, but not in the tool we created with the activity.
Okay, thank you, and thank you for an interesting demonstration. I'm sure everyone and each of us are very looking forward to do assessment in non-cognitive skills. And as for participants, may I kindly remind you that the next session is in the main room, which is day one recap. And thank you for attending this session. Have a good day. Thank you again, Romy Norholt.
And very welcome. Thank you.